Hey guys, David Kwan here. So this video is pretty much a spoiler vlog on Batman Arkham City. If you don't care about spoilers, if you already played the game, this is pretty much the video where, spoilers are a fair game about Arkham City. It's like I said in just talking about Batman Arkham City, it begins so interestingly. I think this series as a whole. There's been two games now in the series, but both games begins really interestingly. It feels like in some ways total contrast to Arkham Asylum. Arkham Asylum begins with a triumph. Joker is captured, and you're putting him in this Arkham Asylum. It feels like a victory, only to realize that it's actually a trap set by Joker. So it's a victory gone wrong. You know, that's Arkham Asylum. Arkham City, though, is a total contrast in that it begins with Bruce Wayne beaten and imprisoned, and his identity is not a secret anymore to one of the main villains, Doctor Strange. So it's also really interesting. You're actually controlling Bruce Wayne in the beginning. He's out of his suit, and you're climbing up. You beat the crap out of the Penguin. That was just a beginning introduction of this city as a whole, Batman just being put in here. It shows a great deal about the vibe of this game that is dark. And I played it after watching The Dark Knight Returns. And in my opinion, The Dark Knight Returns was a really dark movie, one of the darkest movies I've seen out of a comic book franchise made into a movie. So, yeah, and Arkham City kind of carries that vibe along with it. There is this gigantic playground where criminals just rule it. It's as big as a city, but if it's supposed to be, like treated like a prison, it certainly doesn't feel like it. It just feels like a playground that the criminals control. And then there's all these villains separated out. You know, there's different factions, the Joker, Joker's goons. There's the Penguin's goons. So each different section has, is controlled by different types of goons in support of a villain, which I thought was interesting. And they're like rivals, The Penguin goons does not like the Joker goons. The Riddler goons does not like. So it's been interesting to kind of hear the back chatter between them talking shit about each other's. It's just like, I heard Joker's dead. Yeah, Batman took it out. That son of a bitch deserved it. It's really interesting to hear this back chatter going on between the rival gangs, rival villains. So that was really well done, and it's also really well done, like, pacing-wise. Because as you start taking down villains, that chatter changes. And the goons you beat up changes too. First, you're beating up the Penguin's goons, and then you take out the Penguin, and then now you're fighting against Mr. Freeze's goons. I don't remember quite which, but the goons changes, the chatter changes. It's so interesting. It really compels you to keep going to take this villain out, only to see that this other villain is involved too. But at the same time, this whole thing is tied into the Joker scheme. In both games, in the Arkham Asylum and in Arkham City, the Joker has the biggest role to play as a villain. And it makes sense. And he does a good trick in the beginning of Batman. It's almost kind of expected that like Joker would be there to do something. But then even when he does it, it's still really surprising. He injects the Titan Serum into Batman. It's just like, yeah, you have to cure me because guess what? You are infected with it too now. And seeing Batman just get more and more infected with this virus and just seeing him get beat up is just something to see. The game starts out dark, but holy shit does it get crazy. So just that fact alone, just the vibe of this game was such an amazing thing to see. And it's so compelling to see like what happens next. The thing about Arkham City story though is there's some big plot holes here. And I think that the one thing that like irritated me the most was confronting Mr. Freeze. Yes, I mean it's an awesome boss fight. In the gameplay sense, I love the fact that I was able to battle Mr. Freeze. And I love the fact that the boss fight itself was so original. You attack Mr. Freeze with one method, you know, hide under a vent, pop out, and just attack him that way. That no longer becomes usable because now Mr. Freeze shoots out these like ice beams in front of him, so that you can no longer you can no longer be under him because it'll hurt you. It was so amazingly done. Every time you use one method to attack Mr. Freeze, it becomes null, and the game displays that graphically as well. Mr. Freeze starts doing things, and he learns your behavior, and you have to adapt. He has to adapt. That boss fight was just so original to me. And as I've said in another video, it's, in my opinion, it's like the best boss fight this generation. There's not many other games I can think of that has boss games to that level of originality, in my opinion. I mean, there's a lot of games that have awesome boss fights in this generation. God of War 3 was pretty much, it started with one fantastic boss fight. Metal Gear Solid 4 certainly had pretty cool boss fights. Interesting and weird ones. And Vanquish had great boss fights. Demon Souls is pretty much all about the bosses. And Dark Souls as well. But, I don't know. That boss fight to me just felt so fresh and unique and original. It just had me so much in love. But the plot hole is, why am I fighting Mr. Freeze? It makes no sense. So, I mean, I understand he's a Batman villain, but up to that point in the game, Batman has pretty much done everything Freeze has asked him to do. It was because of Batman that Freeze got his suit and gun back from the Penguin. Batman nearly died obtaining the blood of Ra's al Ghul so that Freeze can use it to develop a cure for the Titan Syndrome. Freeze knows Joker was the one who kidnapped Freeze's wife. The most reasonable thing for Freeze to do at this point would be to ask Batman to rescue his wife from Joker and then demand that the only way he would give Batman the cure was if he got his wife back. That's the most sensible thing for Mr. Freeze to do. He's used Batman all this time. Why are you suddenly fighting him? And because during that fight, that gave Joker the time to go into the safe and steal the cure from him. So, you know, I understand it's a plot device, but that fight happened just so arbitrarily. It's like, oh yeah, Mr. Freeze wants to fight you now. So that's what we're doing. And here's what we're doing in the story, that during that fight, Harley Quinn, the character, came in, went to your locker and stole the cure. Alright, now you have to chase that. Now you have to chase the Joker and Harley Quinn. So that's weird. Another weird moment was, the fact that I'm bringing up Mr. Freeze is because up to that point, the game story felt so cohesive. It had this compelling narrative, it had this vibe, had this atmosphere, and you know, the plots were, it was making sense up to that point. You know, things were happening, and it's like, I know why I'm here, I know why this is going on. And then there's that break. It was so disorienting to have that plot hole right there. And then the other plot hole that just kind of took me out of the narrative was when Ra's al Ghul showed up and killed Doctor Strange at the top of the Wonder Tower. And then revealing that he was behind the whole charade all along. And that was just weird. It just didn't break me out of the game, but it was just a weird thing to happen. Like, why did Ra's al Ghul just suddenly come up and killed Dr. Strange? I mean, it was one of the final moments of the game, and it kind of is there, I understand, as a story point. Like, but it's also one of those things where the writer just wrote it to have this next thing happen. So it just totally broke me out of that immersion. So there's the two big plot holes there, where the stuff happens, but it doesn't make sense why I'm fighting Mr. Strange, why I'm fighting Mr. Freeze. Cool fight. I don't know why I'm fighting him, but it happens. And then why Ra's al Ghul just suddenly comes out of nowhere and pretty much sacrifices himself, revealing that he was behind the whole thing and then just dies. That was weird, I didn't expect to... Because I already fought Ra's al Ghul in pretty much that whole sequence there. Like, why did he come again? Only to die. And Batman makes the joke, like, he's probably not dead. He'll probably come back to life again because he's immortal. Whatever. That was weird. But the game ends really powerfully. Man, the ending scene of this game was just like, holy shit. So that's what happened. The Joker dying. Joker is dead. That's how you end the Batman game. And then Batman carries him out with Joker's body. So the Joker is the most iconic character in both of the games. And now he's dead at the end of Batman Arkham City. It really makes you wonder, where does Rocksteady Studio go from here without Joker in the Batman universe? There's so many questions now, but that ending scene was pretty much one of the most powerful scenes ever. Like, that was amazing. So, as I said before, like, the story of Batman Arkham City is so compelling. The narrative has such an established vibe to it that I felt so driven to keep on playing and to see where the story goes. The story does such a great job with that. The two plot holes took me out of the immersion, but it's one of the most immersive stories, even if it wasn't a licensed Batman story as overall. Just the story itself was really a great, compelling story. So on that note, I will end this video with that.